So hi, my name is Piotr, but you can call me Peter because it's easier to pronounce. I'm an NI guy, and this is just a presentation about one of the tools that I created for my team that I'm working with. We are doing software development, so I'm a software engineer. And this is a kind of a universal tool that I thought that you might benefit from as well. And as a part of it, I connected this topic of dependency injection, a practical example of dependency injection, because we are talking about these plugin architectures all the time as architects, but we don't see examples of those very frequently. And I just wanted to share you the open code that I have here and how it looks like in the background. And so this will be the agenda. I'm not going to focus too much on this. But essentially, I'm going to show you how others do it, then how we do it in LabVIEW so far, then why it's bad, what can we improve, and how this User Interface Manager tool actually does the improvement. And then I'm going to show you how it works a little bit in the background and summarize. So the problem statement is this. You definitely worked on many applications, many big applications that had many controls and indicators on many user interfaces, and there came a point where you needed to switch the user interface, let's say, from mode 1 to mode 2. So, like from operator user interface to technician user interface or debug user interface. And there were all of these property nodes, probably, involved in doing that. Right? So the problem statement is, you have many UIs, hundreds of controls and indicators on each of them, many tens or hundreds of user interface states that they can be in, and that equals thousands of properties that need to be manipulated. And how is it done in LabVIEW so far? Well, you can, of course, use the property nodes that are available. But this is kind of a clunky solution, and probably you have your own solutions to this. I'm not expecting that you did stuff like that and didn't figure out that it's a problem. It's big, clunky, doesn't fit on the screen, wiring problems, race conditions, all of this kind of bad stuff with property nodes, and it's frustrating, and it leads to bugs, because if you try to find which property I set incorrectly, and this is your design, well, you're going to have a bad time. And it's also not very friendly when it comes to source code control. Because let's imagine a situation you want to do a change to the user interface, and you have to recompile your code. Like, why? It's just one property that I want to change. I don't want to modify the whole VI, right? So others do it using some kind of application markup language, right? An application markup language can be XAML with Microsoft. Others do it differently. But essentially, it boils down to text that you pass to extract the properties of the user interface. So it's easy to edit because it's text. It's structured. It's possible. It's scriptable. And maybe the most important thing is the user interface definition is kind of detached from the code itself. So if you need to make the changes on user interface, you don't need to touch the code or recompile the executable. You just provide a new configuration file to the customer, for example. Right? So this is not available in LabVIEW. Sad, right? So maybe there is a solution. And I had this problem exactly in my team. We had a situation where we were developing an application that wasn't very big. It was actually just some kind of a calibration helper kind of utility, but it already had many of these problems, and we essentially needed to create a 5-page document in Word. We used some kind of note-taking tool for that, but we created a long document just for one state, and then we had many states, and then somebody needed to go through that and manually map these settings to property nodes in LabVIEW. Of course, that's bad time. Right? So, that is User Interface Manager. So this is an XML-based programmatic API tool for LabVIEW. And I wrote it for my team, and I put it on the community. And it's available for you right now. You can already download it. And it's free, and but it's sample code license. So watch out, because there might be a bug. So don't hold me too responsible for that. So you need to check it out, of course. And it allows you to essentially simplify this process. You no longer need to go through property nodes yourself. But instead, what you do is you create the definitions, create the XML files, and then you just load them, and you apply specific user interface state. And then you apply a different user interface state. And the way how you manipulate with them is by name. A state defines many properties for many controls. So it's text, it's friendly for the source code control. When you need to make a change, you just change it in that XML file, and you apply again the state to your VI. It's also plugin-based, therefore it's extensible, and this plugin-ness is connected to dependency injection. So the tool, this tool that you see here, it installs as a as an additional thing in your tools menu in LabVIEW. So you get this kind of interface. And here you have these options. So you can select a VI that is associated with a project. You can define a name for a state that you want to capture. You can capture that state. Then from a list of states that you have already captured, you can select the one. And you can apply that state to a VI. You can remove a state if you don't want to have it anymore. Save this to XML, load it from XML. And you have the view here of what you've captured before. Also, you have these plugins that you can work with. And the plugins define for you what you're actually capturing. So you can add plugins that you've created. You can remove the ones that are added in the list. You can enable or disable them. And also, if you're not satisfied with the functionality that is available there by default, because there will be some plugins already here, but maybe not all of them that you need, you can create new ones with this button here. And it has an API as well that does the same things as the tool does. So you can do all of this programmatically as well. And if the tool is not helpful enough, so it's already too many steps, I need to open the tool in the menu and I need to capture and name it, it's already too slow for me, you can use the Control-U, Control-Space shortcut, which captures the state of a VI for you with the default plugins that are available in the tool. So let me show you maybe a demonstration of that. Oh, and by the way, it installs as a VI package. So when you go to the website that has it, you will download this VI package, and you will install it like this using the package manager. And then you can open up the examples, and it will give you the example folder. So in the examples, you can, let's say, let's open localization VI. And this localization VI, I will go to Tools and User Manager Tool. I will point to the VI that I'm interested in, this one, and I can capture the state of that VI. And when I capture the state of that VI, the simplest modification that I can do for you guys is to move something around and say something like this, like that, and capture this as a different state. And then I can apply the states that I've captured before. And this works independently if the VI is running or not. So you can actually apply them like this as well. So this state that I've captured here, thanks. So this the state that I've captured here is captured by the tool like that, but this is this takes a long time to do it. So you can close the tool if you don't want to do it like this. Let's stop this control space. And Control-U will capture the shortcut for you as well. So Control U, you get the state 0 captured to the XML file. So this represents with the default plugins that you have in the tool, captures all of them and saves it to the file. If you want to make it a little bit more meaningful what you're actually capturing, which is helpful actually for this, because this is a localization example, I have this menu in English right now. So let me control space and type in English. English. And control shift U. And it's going to capture with the name that you type in to the quick drop as well. So you have this many different ways how you can capture these states actually. And then once you capture them, I have a fun example for this. Let me open the tools and UI Manager tool. I wasn't satisfied with the default plugins that are available here, so I created my own ones that are changing the color scheme of the user interface. So let me just point to those. And if you have a folder with many of the plugins that you've created, you don't have to point to them one by one. These are LabVIEW classes, by the way. You don't have to point to them one by one. Just select a whole folder, and it's going to load all of them if the class is matching a plugin. So let's disable and enable only the ones that I'm interested in, color and color. And let me load a previously saved configuration for colors. So this is my color scheme. And you can have as many files like this as you want. You just load them, change the state of the UI to the thing that you want. You can load a different XML after that, change again. So you can have resolutions, you can have localization, color schemes, whatever you want. As long as it's a property in a property in VI servers, it can be handled like this. So I have color schemes here. So if you're doing a presentation for a military customer, like you might want to apply, select the VI. You might want to apply the dark green color scheme. Or if you are doing a presentation for a customer in the movie industry or something, then epic color scheme, right? So these are plugins that I created additionally. They are not part of the tool by itself. And you can create them like this. So this button here creates a new class for you from a template. Then that template, and let me get back to the presentation. It's gonna show. First of all, before we go to the template, the structure of the XML. So this is the representation that is used. I've found this to be the most readable when it comes to source code control as well. Because I could represent it in many different ways, but essentially that would be modifying, if I wanted to have it as properties of this control in XML, properties of control that would be modifying the same line. So I wouldn't want to do that necessarily. So I just created all of these properties as separate lines so that you can easily see that there is a new property there. And all of them are based on the name of the plugin class. So you see the class name is here, so visible user interface property, that's class name. And then the way how it's flattened to string, you define that when you create the plugin, essentially. So this is your job if you're creating a new plugin, you define the way how the string will be passed then for the value. So this is structured, easy to edit, passable, scriptable, and it's completely detached from your executable, right? So you can load it by adding the function calls from the API to your executable, and then nothing changes in the executable, and you have different user interface. So this is dependency injection. We have these plugins that we are working with, and the tool by itself, if it didn't have any plugins, it would be kind of useless. Right? So the whole point of the tool is that all of the dependencies that we need, they are loaded. So the dependencies here of the plugin classes and the methods, and the injection thing is loading them from a folder when we need them. Right? The way how it looks inside of the API, so the code is open, by the way, so you can have a look inside. I made some design choices that might be controversial in the code. So again, there is a forum. You can send emails to me. I will try to, you know, do my best to respond to them. And so this is loading all of the ones that are in a specific folder. So I'm listing a folder, and all of the ones that are in the folder and are user interface plugins will be loaded to my dictionary of definitions. So you can load any that you create. And this is the way how they are how the value is extracted from the XML file. So here I try to find the name of the property that I read from the XML file, and I added this, it's a Labio class, so it's like that, and I search if this definition actually exists in the definitions that I know. And if it does, I convert the value using one of the methods that are defined as the plugin method. So unflattening the string value for that specific plugin that I'm working on. And this is how it's used when you apply the state to a user interface. So you essentially take all of the properties that you've captured for that user interface. It's also a dictionary, so you just have an array of these properties. And then, based on another method of a property, you just set it on a specific reference to a specific control on the user interface. And this is done, this is an important thing to remember, this is done by label. Right? So label has to be unique. And if it changes, it stops working. Yeah? There wasn't a better way for me to do it to make it readable. So you have to remember about that limitations. So when you're doing localization, please change the caption and not the label. And this is the plugin. So it's very simple. It's an abstract class. Doesn't have any functionality in the methods. It's just the interface for these five methods that you need to make it work if you create your own plugin. So it's a get state, set state, list compatible controls, and this is you define a property for a specific type in VI Server. So for example, for Boolean controls. So the compatible type is Boolean for you. And you shouldn't try to invoke one property for incompatible types, because it's not going to work. You're not going to get an error, you're just going to get a warning that you're trying to do something that doesn't work. And then flattening and unflattening the value of, that is represented in the XML file. And this template is available in the UI Manager tool. So you can just click, save the template somewhere, edit, and it works. So this is an example of how I wrote this Boolean color user interface property for changing the color theme of the VI. So this is getting the property. Quite simple, you just get the specific property that you're interested in, and you save it as a part of the data of your plugin class. Setting is the reverse of that. Again, very simple. It's just important to remember that this needs to be typecast here, so that you cast the actual reference that you're working with to be able to set it. Listing compatible controls, in this case, Boolean color is compatible only with Booleans. So you just list an array of controls, and those are corresponding to the VI server names of different types. Then you need to flatten somehow to a string, unflatten from a string, and you have a plugin. So I tried to make it as simple as possible, as minimum number of methods that you can write to achieve what you need, and this is what I came up with. If you have some feedback how it might be improved, just let me know. Yeah?
Do you have tutorials or videos on what you just showed? I mean, we're obviously going to have this video later, but do you have anything like that?
Yeah, I have some presentations on how things can be done here on YouTube, on my channel. And if you search for User Interface Manager on our community, I will show you the link at the end. and you have the videos embedded in that table. Yeah?
Did you include clusters, pages, and so on?
Yeah, so in the API, there is an option that you can traverse clusters for the controls. But it's disabled by default because I actually thought that you might not want to modify how a cluster, internal cluster controls behave. But if you do want to do that, you can use the API to enable that option. It's going to be a little bit more difficult, but it's there.
You don't enable that on a plugin by plugin basis?
That's a good idea. I might do that. Okay. I might do that, but right now I don't. Any more questions right now? Yeah?
So when you apply the properties from your saved themes,
yeah.
Does it apply them all sequentially, or do you run them all in parallel, such that the basis for my question is, if you wanted one of those application methods to actually do something dynamic, such as slide a control rather than just move it from A to B, you might want them all to occur simultaneously. Can that kind of thing be supported?
It's not supported right now. The way how it's done, the ordering is something that you cannot control here, unfortunately. Because if somebody edits your XML file, that changes the order that the property is in, essentially when it's passed out. And I cannot control the order very well here, so I don't do these kinds of things. So it's not a dynamic mechanism, but rather static.
I think that's why my question was if you could do them all in parallel, so the orders are irrelevant.
Well, if you try to do them in parallel, you still have the problem of having one user interface thread, and that might not actually achieve what you want. Yeah.
So instead of using a file, can you also use a string?
Instead
of using a file as an input, can you also use a string?
String as an input. No, not right now. But you can save that string to a file and then use it.
I want to do crazy stuff like change the string or the XML data in my application and then put it in there or get it from a database.
Right now, unfortunately, you have to save it using the API to a file.
It would be like a minor change.
Yeah, but if there is enough question behind, enough push behind that, I will add it, no problem. This is the last thing, just a moment. And so this is the last thing that I wanted to show you, and then I have just a summary slide. So this is the universal code example. So if you add this to your executable, you're capable of using this in any application, right? So you need to obtain the user interface manager, then you need to load the file that you're interested in. If you want to, you can list the states that you have available. I do it in the examples that are attached, but you don't have to. If you know the names of the states, then you don't have to list them. And then you just use the apply user interface state method, and you have set what you need. And the API also works by default with the VI, with the reference to the VI that it's called in. So if I call it the API here and apply, just like that, and it's going to apply it to this VI, right? So it's the calling VI by default, but you can specify any reference there to just provide the VI reference. And also it works on all controls by default. If you want to limit on which controls it should be applied, again, provide an array of controls, control references there.
Does it recurse into test pages?
Yes, it does. So it recurses only into panes and tabs. It doesn't recurse into clusters by default, like there was a question. No, it doesn't go into subpanels. Subpanels are not.
What do you mean with it doesn't go to subpanels? What do you mean with it doesn't go to subpanels? In the end, the subpanel is another VI.
But it's a different VI that has a different reference, so you need to point to that.
Yeah, but if you point to that one, yes, that will be a problem.
In that case it does, but it doesn't, if you just point to a VI front panel, and there is a sub panel there, it's not going to go inside of that VI. Yeah. Any more questions? Yes?
I'm curious, do you find yourself using this for dynamic localization of front panels a lot?
Not a lot, but I use it in my projects all the time.
But you can do it.
I could, yes. I don't localize so much, but if I did, I would use this probably. Yeah? You could. You can do whatever you want there, really, because you have access to a reference, right? It's designed for a specific thing, but you can put invoke nodes also inside of those plugins. You can put event registration there, so you can do crazy stuff, and but it's not encouraged.
So you said in the plugin you give an array of supported...
Yes, types.
Presumably that is always going to be the most specific type?
Yes, yes, and you're always going to point to the specific type to that is supported, and the basic plugins, they work with any type because they are defined on the level of a control, yeah, generic control.
So you could put I support control and the plugin...
Yes, exactly. Yeah.
That's what I'm curious about, the method that you are using to resize the controls, because I think the only, that there are, for instance, no properties to scale the outside of the graph. You have to change the graph area.
I remember that I had some problems with that. But
the only way I know that will scale any control is by using exported function in LabVIEW. But if you know a better way, then... I always use a function called resize object from that, and it will basically resize any control that thing. It uses a delta, delta x and delta a. So you do it the hard way.
Yeah, I do it the hard way. I remember that I had some problems with it, but I didn't remember that this was the problem. Yeah, hard way.
But if you go to a graph or a chart, then,
it might not be the most beautiful solution.
Probably you have to change.
Plot area size I change.
Yes, so but that means that the outside is not really...
Might not be perfect. Might not be. But that's why it's extensible.
If you want that, the item will still the outside of any
symbol. Yeah. Yeah. Any more questions? Yeah? Splitters, no. Unfortunately, no. But again, like with everything, if you post enough on the forum associated with this, I might do it. I didn't look into that, so I don't know if it's even possible. And this is the summary. So, can be used by anyone. Doesn't matter if you are just inverting to default values for controls or indicators. If you are working with resolutions, color themes, localization, just it does everything. Big applications, of course, gain more with this. For small applications, maybe just doing it with property nodes is the way to go. So don't use it all the time. And also the performance here. Remember that there is a performance hit associated with being able to, you know, traverse through all of the properties and index everything and dynamically dispatch. So for a small application, that performance might be considerable hit. For a bigger application, you're actually going to get better performance with this other than doing it yourself, because there are some things that you can do in an API that does. You know, everything is connected together, so I disable the panel updates, defer the panel updates in the stack, then at the end of update, I enable them again, so you get better performance like this. So, bigger applications gain more. It detaches the UI editing from source code, so that's a big win, in my opinion, and allows for easier team-based development, because you can have multiple people working on multiple UI kind of modes, and then you integrate everything together in one file. Yeah?
He said that he suspends the UI. That would answer the question earlier about whether you can put animations in your own update loop.
Oh, yeah.
It wouldn't work because the updates are suspended.
Yeah. Yeah?
So one problem that I have is that I have two modes in my application, one for operator and one for configurator. All the controls are exactly the same. And the only way to disable them for the operator is to make them grayed out and disabled.
Yeah.
So,
this handles this.
I know it's not possible in that view, but what would be really nice if the control has a property that can switch it to look like an indicator.
Oh, no. That's
I know it's not possible now, but since you work at an I, maybe
you can. But what you can do is you can have an indicator and a control, put them on top of each other,
but
make one visible, make the other invisible.
But I have like 80 of them, so.
But the tool can do a lot of things for you, so that might work still. Yeah?
Would it be possible to modify the properties within an X control?
Within a what, sorry?
X control.
X control. Yeah, I had this question already. Right now I don't do anything with X controls, and I didn't even try it. But it's, again, plugin-based, so if you create a plugin that works with your X-Control, then I don't see why not.
You shouldn't be using X-Controls anyway.
I didn't use them. I didn't use them. Yeah? Yeah, that's why there is the whole presentation associated with this. This is with quotation marks, maybe I should add them here. But it's not getting us all the way there like XAML would, and I'm not saying that it can do even the things that XAML does, but it's at least a step in the right direction, I believe. And I'm done. Thank you.